Good morning, everyone, and welcome to week 8, the final week this year of Great Decisions at Manitowoc Public Library. Thank you all so much for coming down. Before we get started, as always, I have a couple of announcements. Thank you once again to the Friends of the Manitowoc Public Library for the refreshments that they have supplied all 8 weeks. So, a big hand to them. Next, you couldn't help but probably notice the surveys that were on your seats when you came in. A couple things about that. First off, if you would like to see a topic addressed that I didn't include on the bottom portion, please feel free to write that in. All right, those were just 9 potential topics, but there are a plethora of topics that we can address. The second thing is, you may have noticed that I neglected to put an age category for over the age of 64. Or in my defense, after seeing most of you for the past 7 weeks, I just assumed everyone was in the 18 to 24 age group. So, please pardon my omission, and if you would like to check off or write in anything over the age of 64, although I'm inclined not to believe it. The last thing before I bring Kathy Fishbeck up to introduce our speaker this evening, just wanted one last time to mention that while the Friends do a great job of supporting the library with the ability to provide some of the quality programming and the diversity of the programming that we get to present, we can always use more donations in order to keep that river flowing. To that end, if you are even considering donating something to the Library Foundation, there are pamphlets over there as always, right next to where you should leave your survey forms, by the way. If you're interested in donating to the foundation, to the Library Foundation, those pamphlets explain it way better than I could. So if you're inclined, they're waiting. So without further ado, let's get on with the lecture, and I would like to bring up Kathy Fishbeck from the League of Women Voters to introduce tonight's speaker.
Thank you, Tim. Tim has been very gracious throughout these 8 years. Thank you.
It is on.
Tim has been very
Tim
has been very gracious over the last 8 weeks to thank everybody that's been involved. But I think it could not have come off as successfully without Tim. So thank you, Tim, so much for being here. I just want to say something in addition to what he said about putting your donations over there. I grew up here in Manitowoc and left and had a career and then came back to Manitowoc. And my library days began across from Bankers National, where Bankers National was right there. And then moved over to where Lakeside Friends is, and then it came there. Now, some of you who are a little older than I am may have had a library previous to that. But the library has always been an important part of my life and my family's life. So one of the things that I plan to do when I have said goodbye to everybody is to put in my will something for the library. So I would encourage anybody who is in that kind of a position to think about the library, because what is a city without a library? And we're all kind of appalled that the library here in Manitowoc can't be open on Thursdays. So we need to do whatever we can to support this, because most of the people here are people that I've seen for the last 10 years. This is a wonderful program, and because of the generosity of so many people, the library is the wonderful library that it is. So anyway, just a little personal note that it's a great place to spend your money. It's a great place to spend your money evenings in February and March. As we look for speakers, one of the things that we do is always write letters at the beginning of the season to people who have spoken here before. And John Koska, who's a diplomat, is one of the people that has spoken here, and he's done a great job, so of course we sent him a letter, and he said, well, you know, there aren't any topics that are really in my area, but I do know someone that can speak about Pakistan and Afghanistan. And so he graciously wrote an email to Peter, and said, you know, I have some good friends there in Manitowoc who have this wonderful program. I bet you'd enjoy going there. Well, luckily he said he would, and so Peter is here to talk to us today on Afghanistan, the prospects in Afghanistan and Pakistan. Peter Kranstover grew up in West Bend, so like many of us, he spent time growing up in Wisconsin, went off and had a career someplace else, and for various reasons ended up back here in the state of Wisconsin. He did his undergraduate work at St. Cross in the Boston or Greater Boston area. And I asked him, you know, why Boston? We wanted to get away from West Bend, as many of us do, and decided that he would go to wonderful liberal arts college. That's what he did. He did his graduate work at Oxford and at the University of Wisconsin in economics and agricultural economics. He served as a Peace Corps representative in Guatemala. And after that, he began his career as a foreign service advisor, foreign service diplomat in the USAID. And he's had assignments all over the world. I thought to myself as reading his resume and thinking about what we were talking about, that actually we didn't even need to get him to speak. We could just stand here and ask him questions because he knows so much all over the world. But anyway, he spent time as a foreign service officer in Latin America, in Africa. He was most recently in Pakistan, and then spent quite a bit of time with his wife, Annie Lewandowski, who is here with us, Lucy, as director of Central American and American and Mexican Affairs, as director of development for the U.S. Committee on Refugees and Immigrants, as a policy advisor on Latin America for the Office of Foreign Assistance at the State Department. He is something unique for us this year. All of the other people that we have had speak have been academics. He brings a little different perspective as a diplomat and a foreign service person. He's an adjunct professor on international economics at Marquette. He's a board member in Marquette's Center for Global and Economic Studies. And he's on the Wisconsin's Advisory Council to the U.S. Global Leadership Coalition of Washington, D.C. He and his wife, Annie Lewandowski, have three adult children. I think two of them are in Virginia and one is in Arizona. Okay. We had a wonderful time at supper with them, and so it's a pleasure to welcome you, Annie, and certainly join me in welcoming Peter Kranstover.
Kathy, thanks so much for that kind introduction. I'm reminded, as you were doing that, that I'm neglected to tell you that I spent 3 or 4 months between graduate schools at the Slinger Foundry, which many, many years ago, which some of you probably know, no longer exists, thank God, but was probably as formative an experience for me as Peace Corps or graduate school. So I appreciate that kind introduction. I've got just maybe 11 slides here, and I usually use them if only to provide a little bit of framework or context. I think my philosophy is if you get a little too many, that I might lose you all. So, but as we go through this, I just want you to think about one theme here for both of these countries, which are really, you know, linked historically and certainly in contemporaneous terms right now, at the hip, because of all kinds of considerations that go back hundreds and hundreds of years and started really with the establishment there of the first government structure there that the Mughals put in. The Mughals, tracing their lineage and background to the tribes of Central Asia who swept in the 14 and 1500s and pretty much took all of this area here, all the way down to the Arabian Sea, and actually had what we now call New Delhi and all these places there, and actually went further down past Mumbai, establishing governance structures there and giving history names like Tamerlane and Babur and Akbar, who established really a very tolerant sort of mixed state of Christians and Jews and Muslims, and all of whom lived quite nicely together during that time, for 250 years more or less. The British come in to the area in 1600 and come in here to Bombay, or what we now call Mumbai, Portuguese, at least as far as the Europeans were concerned, discovered, and begin to colonize that particular area. And ultimately, after the mutiny of 1857 in India, imposed direct rule. Now remember, Pakistan doesn't exist at this time. Pakistan only comes into being in 1947. Afghanistan really sort of comes into being about 1919, after going through approximately three different wars beginning in 1838 with the Brits, who always wanted influence in this particular area, mainly to protect all of that good trading element that the British, by coming in the 1600s, in 1600 into Bombay, had established and were, of course, exploiting for their own economic purposes. The Brits put in what is the modern day border, called the Durand Line, in the 1870s, after convincing the Russians, who wanted to come down here and have this warm water port, as they always did, that really this wasn't, as far as the Brits were concerned, any part of the Russian sphere of influence. The Russians said, okay, we can do that, we'll agree to that. So that's how you get more or less the modern contours of Afghanistan, 1870s, 1873 or so. In the meantime, independence movements are beginning. A fellow by the name of Syed Khan, who was a Muslim intellectual in the subcontinent at that time, starts to talk about Muslim nationalism. He sees Hindu population growth rates really getting moving apace, certainly if not overtaking Muslim populations throughout the whole subcontinent. And he starts talking about an independent state. He isn't entirely clear what that's going to look like. But he does sort of lay the philosophical groundwork for what eventually, and I'm going to jump way ahead now, becomes this Muslim movement in the subcontinent that begins in earnest right after World War I, gains ground in the 20s and the 30s, and ultimately leads to independence and the establishment of Pakistan in August of 1947. Now, this bothered the Afghanis a little bit because they said, well, I guess we're not going to be able to do anything here with the Durand Line, as it was called. And these, are going to be our established borders here. Despite the fact that this area here, this whole area here, is what they call the Pashtun area, or Pakhtun, or sometimes you'll see it in old books, they'll spell it P-A-T-H-A-N, Pakhtuns. Churchill writes about it in a book, one of his first books, I think it's his first book, called Malakhan Field Force, as Pathans, he calls them, or sometimes referring to them. It's one of the more politically incorrect books that you can read about the area. you might imagine. And he fought as a young soldier up there, actually, in this particular area, quelling the infidel tribes, as he says sometimes. And this became ultimately an area that the British, and frankly the Pakistanis to this day, don't even bother with from their federally established government in Islamabad, the capital of Islamabad. Because it's distant, it's difficult, it's extremely isolated physically, culturally, and of course it happens to be the area where most of the Taliban came out of, and where Osama bin Laden moved to after October of 2001. So that's a little bit of quick background there for you. And just to give you, because I'm somewhat partial to this type of emphasis, simply because of the kind of work that I did. But let me just throw a couple of numbers at you so you get a little bit of an understanding of, you can appreciate. There's a good shot, a good picture of Afghanistan with Islamabad, the capital. think about right here, right now, which has been the capital since 1960. Karachi used to be the capital of Pakistan, but down here, it's about 20 million people at the moment. Islamabad's about 2 million people, which is where all the government buildings are. There's one of Pakistan. But both of these countries, Pakistan and Afghanistan, are tied together because of the Mughal Empire, because of ethnic and economic considerations, because of religion, certainly 96% in total Muslim, tiny populations of Christians and Hindus, Zoroastrians, Ahmadis, who are sort of apostate as far as the regular Muslims are concerned, Muslims. But suffer really from some awful sort of social statistics that involve bad education, high infant mortality rates, really, really low economic growth rates, although in the past maybe 15 years, Pakistan did do okay. But after 2008, 2009, like a lot of these places, around the world after the financial crash, things got rather difficult for them. Now, so here you've got the capital, Rawalpindi, the big military base, Karachi down here, Hyderabad, Quetta, which is sort of the frontier area, Peshawar, which used to be an Afghan area up until about 150 years ago. And the Afghans still consider it, at least most of the Pashtuns, it was part of their area. Although we do have a US consulate up there. And then, let me just jump to this. A couple of notes regarding their Pakistan's current situation. The GNP of about 270 billion. And for those of you who stay in touch with economic activity here in Wisconsin, you'll know that our GNP, or our gross national, our gross state product, is about 245 billion. We're about 6.5 million people. So Pakistan's got about $270 billion a year that they make. Got 185 million people. In 1981, there were 84 million people in Pakistan. 1981, 84 million. As we speak, there's about 185 million people in Pakistan without too much economic growth. One big thing that started Pakistan off on its nuclear program, nuclear weapons, was the civil war that they had in 1970-71. This, as you might remember, involved what we used to call East Pakistan, now known as Bangladesh, which broke off and saw the loss of some 1 million to 3 million people during that civil war. Bangladesh, or as it was called, East Pakistan at that time, did not have an Urdu-speaking majority like West Pakistan did. Ethnically, they were a little bit different. They were Muslims, certainly. But they had been divided and moved over there, carved out that particular piece of Pakistan in the partition in 1947, somewhat stupidly in retrospect. So East Pakistan and West Pakistan are 1,000 miles from each other, and they happen to be the same country. Well, political and ethnic and economic issues all came to the fore, and this is a whole story in itself, resulted in this awful civil war, which the US sort of stood by and observed, particularly because Henry Kissinger, who wanted to not get the West Pakistanis annoyed, said, we're not going to intervene in there in Bangladesh and stop this killing. And there were lots of killings. There was a lot of human rights abuses in Bangladesh during this time. But he was considering Nixon going to China at the time. And the West Pakistanis were sort of helping us in that regard with respect to talks and serving as surrogates, if you will, with the Chinese before Nixon went off there. So part of that, part of our diplomatic history is a little bit stained by the fact that we didn't happen to move in there and stop the West Pakistani army from murdering a lot of the East Pakistanis or ultimately the Bangladeshis would happen to be asking for some type of independence or autonomy. Because the Pakistanis lose this half or a third of their country, Bhutto, the guy who survives this and was ultimately hung in 1979 by General Zia, comes in and he says, I need some nuclear weapons. We never want to be humiliated like that again. And so he brings together a bunch of Pakistani scientists, including a guy named A.Q. Khan, who's educated in the Netherlands, a nuclear scientist. And the long, long story short, and Khan still lives in Islamabad, as we speak. He becomes the father of the nuclear weapons program. The Pakistanis get it. They have one of their first explosions, I think, in 1998, after the Indians do it. The Indians, of course, being Pakistan's moral enemy. Bhutto said, before I die, and even if I have to eat grass, we're going to have nuclear weapons. And he got them. Now, as I say, this is a country with that kind of GNP, not much bigger than Wisconsin's. Few more people, and nuclear weapons. And so one of the things you want to do, at least in diplomatic circles, is remain engaged with these guys, right? You don't want to ignore them. You want to be able to talk to them on occasion and say, we think that we might have some common interests here. As we do with the Indians, of course, who are much larger, at 1.3 billion people, much bigger economy, and also have nuclear weapons. But the ineffective government part is one big thing in Pakistan. It used to be not bad. I was saying to one of our hosts this afternoon that there's a real world-class group of Pakistanis, technocrats, you know, who Western educated, and some locally Indian and Pakistani university educated guys who are perfectly capable of running things. But they're overwhelmed, you know, by a huge population that's under the poverty line that just doesn't make a lot of money. And has also been influenced a lot by fundamentalist Muslim clerics. I just put this last one here. This is what your tax money and mine was like in 2015 regarding foreign assistance in Pakistan, $785 million. And it's about a $346 million plan for fiscal year 2016. Well, that goes into everything from humanitarian aid, food and roads and health clinics and stuff like this, to refugee camps and stuff like that. And that's one of the larger programs in the world. Afghanistan, another place, you know, that's got this fractious history, dwarfed nonetheless by Pakistan in terms of its GDP. Now this is $20 billion in GDP, it's got 33 million people. Now, $20 billion, if you look at this last line down here, you'll note that $11 billion in foreign assistance came in 2015, and that $1.2 billion is planned for 2016. And your foreign assistance, this is just from the U.S., not from the Europeans, not from the Japanese, not from others, is about half of your actual GDP. So if you're going to cut off your foreign assistance to both of these places, particularly to Afghanistan, you're going to have a little bit of an effect, a very deleterious one probably, unless the Afghanis can get it together relatively quickly. One other factor here that I want to mention, and I put this in here because this is another issue that we talked a little bit about. And this is essentially this whole issue of water in this particular part of the world. Now, this is a watershed that involves Pakistan, India, and Afghanistan. Unfortunately, I couldn't find a good map that gives you your sovereign borders either. But basically, here's sort of Afghanistan. And then Pakistan goes down like this, right? And down to here. Up here's Kashmir, this disputed area that Pakistan and India have been fighting over since partition in 1947. They've been to war three times on this issue. And almost went nuclear in 99 when the present president, Mr. Sharif, who's president now, happened to be in power because of issues over sovereignty and who ran Kashmir. one of those 560 principalities of the subcontinent that existed during partition, or just before partition, when the British were negotiating with all the Muslim and Hindu Maharajas, right, and saying, be with us, be against us, or you want to be with Muslims, you want to be with Hindus, and doing negotiating with them in that regard. Kashmir never tilted one way or the other, ultimately. And so it remains to this day a disputatious issue. But the point here is that this is Pakistan's lifeline. And the British in the 30s, 20s, 30s, and 40s put all kinds of dams throughout here. And so about 85% of your agriculture in Pakistan happens to be rain-fed. It's irrigated. And so you've got wheat and cotton, a little bit of sugar cane, all throughout here that is essential to their economy, some of their export growth, and just as important is also the source of a lot of their electricity. They're running on hydropower. They about 30-40% of this water goes into hydropower, and then it's used in irrigation purposes. But over the years, snow melt, and I don't want to talk about climate change, but climate change, I'm told, has something to do with the fact the glaciers up here are diminishing. And indeed, the kind of water that they used to have isn't coming down anymore. So fortunately, there's a 1960 Indus Water Treaty that the Indians and the Pakistanis signed together saying, you guys can get this many acre feet of water every year, and you guys can get this much acre feet of water every year. And this is sort of tweaked every year in these annual meetings that the Indians and the Pakistanis have. Fortunately, it's one area that they talk about, because they, of course, recognize how essential this whole basin is. Nonetheless, infrastructure, inefficient dams, turbines that require replacement, things like this, all are issues, as well as just agricultural land that needs to be kept underwater, is all a part of this particular back and forth again between the Indians and the Pakistanis, and more the Afghanis too. Then, of course, you've got the whole issue of insurgents and terrorists. And depending on who you read, Ahmed Rashid, R-A-S-H-I-D, who's a British-trained Pakistani journalist, has written a book called Taliban, and he also follows the insurgent groups he works out of Islamabad. But this is an area, this is part of the Northwest Frontier Provinces, or the federally administered territories, South Waziristan, North Waziristan. This is Al-Qaeda Taliban territory. Here's Islamabad. You can't get in here but with a special escort. And this is where most of the Al-Qaeda guys after 2001 came, and where a number of Pashtun insurgent groups intent on overthrowing the secular government in Islamabad operate from. So, and so it's again, about this isolated area, and happens to be pretty much the heart and soul, the geographic area of Al-Qaeda and the Afghani, as well as the Pakistani Taliban in this particular part of the world. It's pretty well sealed off in that, you know, you've got Pakistani military guys around here, a lot of drone strikes from the United States have gone in here since 2001 in order to get particular Taliban and Al-Qaeda bad guys. Relatively small places, high in the mountains, pretty area, I'm told by people who've been in there, but, you know, really quite remarkably undeveloped in many ways. And then here I just tossed in, this is relatively recent, this is 3 or 4 months old, this is from Al Jazeera, and it gives you a little bit of an idea. Sure, if I can fix this, but this is Afghanistan, and it indicates where the Taliban happen to be at the moment. Let me just see if I can to see if I could. The dark is where the Taliban are. The red is disputed areas. And your gray stuff here is essentially where it's relatively safe, where Afghani government presence is, such as it is. So that's after, 16 years of working and operating out of Kabul, Pakistan, Central Asia, and going after Al-Qaeda. So ultimately, you've got really yet another, what the wonks at the Pentagon sometimes call a complex conflict. You've got a strategic location. You got these three countries, India, Pakistan, and Afghanistan, that are all contiguous. And it was interestingly enough, the Afghans and the Pakistanis really don't get along very well, even though both of their populations are like 95% Muslim. Afghanis get along a little bit better with the Indians for some reason. They're not their present president, but the one before Karzai studied and was exiled, and his family was in India for a long time, and he always used to talk somewhat longingly of being a young man in India. And three different places that, because of all kinds of factors, need to work together, yet don't very well. Terribly underdeveloped. Infant mortality rates in Afghanistan of 120 per thousand. Now, here in the United States, you get about 8 per thousand of infant mortality rates. 120 in Afghanistan, about 85 per thousand in Pakistan. These are sort of off the chart. You find that in Central Africa. It's in Bolivia, Nicaragua, maybe not Nicaragua, Bolivia, Haiti, you get numbers like that. Those are just sort of good benchmarks, if you will, indicative benchmarks, helpful benchmarks, give you a little sense of lack of institutions and development. India and Pakistan, nuclear powers, right? You've got just a tough neighborhood north of there. You've got insurgencies in Kyrgyzstan and Xinjiang province, which is the western province of China, where there's a Muslim insurgency against the Chinese central government. And here are your players. You've got the Iranians right next door, also to the Pakistanis, and just south of Afghanistan, Central Asia and the Chinese. And we're involved there, and for the moment, it looks as if we're going to be for a while. We have about 9,000 troops, American troops on the ground in Afghanistan. And despite the fact that the Obama administration said a few years ago that they would be out of there by the end of 2016, you may recall that this past summer they said, maybe not. We think we'll stick around a little bit longer. And that's probably not a bad decision. And certainly some of the Afghani upper, the higher ups in the government, were concerned. We put in probably $52 billion in the area in Afghanistan since 2002, only to work on security issues or security forces. We probably put in about $110 billion into Afghanistan over that time for not only that, but also for humanitarian assistance and things like that. Now that's pretty much your, that's a huge chunk of the regular foreign assistance budget on an annual basis. We get about $40 billion a year. Your tax money in line for about 120 different countries around the world. So it looks as if I would say we're going to be there for a while. And certainly we're going to remain active amongst the Pakistanis, because the Pakistanis, despite their somewhat regular dysfunction, with all due respect to my Pakistani friends, We are their biggest trading partner. We are one of their regular friends. We blow hot and cold. We didn't get along real well in the 90s. We didn't have any foreign assistance aid there because they wouldn't sign the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. As a matter of fact, they still haven't. So we cut off all assistance to them at that time. But after 2001, it was a different ballgame. And we became friends again. And then we started a big foreign assistance program. So, any further stuff on this, I would recommend them. These being a library. I just thought that I would just mention a couple of very fine pieces. This is relatively recent. This is maybe 3-4 years old. Evans, British American journalist. Owen Bennett Jones, sometimes you hear him on BBC. Reporting from his novel book. Hop Kirk, old journalist guy, wonderful piece on the Great Game, which is Kipling's piece, right? Talks about the Great Game between the British and the Russians in the 1700s and the 1800s. Just some unbelievable stories about these Russian and British agents who were either went by themselves or maybe with one other person and would disappear for a few months, if not a year or two at a time, and just sort of bump around in that particular part of the world and come back to London and report. And then Afghanistan and Pakistan, by an Oxford-educated Pakistan, it is Mohammad Khan, who used to be the foreign minister. And lastly, this is a very readable piece. Cole, you may know, he's the dean of journalism at the University of Columbia in New York, and used to write for, he writes for the New Yorker and Atlantic sometimes. But this is a great thing on the 80s and the 90s in Afghanistan up until 2001. And it's a real gripping story about how we decided to assist the Mujahideen during the 1980s against the Russians, and we used Pakistan as a base, and how we pulled back a little bit there in the 90s, and how, again, we came in after 2001. A lot of this stuff, too, as some of you may know, is in that movie with Tom Hanks.
Charlie Wilson's War.
Charlie Wilson's War, right? By a guy named George Crile. It's a wonderful movie. If you don't want to read the book, just go see the movie, and I think they're both, I think the two are really quite consistent, quite congruent. With that, I'm watching the time a little bit here, but I thought maybe we could have a little bit of a discussion. That's my last slide. So happy to entertain questions and have a little bit of a back and forth here as best we can. I came back in 2013 after about a year and a half there in Pakistan, my last posting. Happy to get back here to the Upper Midwest and might even stay in Wisconsin. So, thank you.
Recently, there was a presentation on public TV that demonstrated China's now desire to get the water out of that hill region that China depicted.
Yeah.
And that, how is that going to affect an area that is so reliant on water?
Yeah, badly, I think. You know, I didn't quite appreciate. I didn't appreciate a lot about this area until I got there, but. So, right, you got China, Afghanistan, India, Pakistan, all pulling water out of this stuff. Here you're at like 23,000 feet, you know, up here in the Himalayan plateau at the beginning of the Indus. And the Chinese are actually, now they built a port called Gwandar down here on the Arabian Sea, which used to be part of the Oman Sultanate, which is on the Saudi Arabian Peninsula. About 1910, the old Omani Sultan said to his Muslim brothers down here, well, I'll give you this piece of land across the Arabian Sea. Well, that became Gwandar. And the Chinese, who have always been close to the Pakistanis, with the Russians being close to the Indians, that's been your Cold War split, which maintains to this day, are building a road that goes like this, up into it actually goes through into Xinjiang province, and it's going to be basically a container port. So the Chinese have tremendous investments in this particular part of the world, and they're concerned about water for this part of their country, which is, as I don't know this, I haven't been in here, but you know, is high and dry, which potentially could have some agricultural use. So, I don't want to be in those negotiations.
Part of the presentation was, is there creating an isthmus off those rivers and pulling those waters into their agricultural district. And it's going to diminish the flows into Indian
Pakistan. Further down here? Sure.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, that stuff, you know, you start talking about water. I mean, I'm old enough to remember when Lee Dreyfus was governor and somebody in the Southwest, in Arizona or New Mexico, said, let's build a canal from the Great Lakes down to the Southwest. And I always remember, you know, sort of talk about a non-starter. Well, I can't imagine what will go on here unless the Pakistanis are willing to negotiate with the Chinese. But then they're going to have to deal with the Indians, because they've signed this 1960 Indus Water Treaty. And it's and here, you know, here you have 60 million people in southern in the province of Sindh, S-I-N-D-H, down here, which is flat and hot and ag, the agricultural, and who rely on this water, you know, for their crops every year. So I just don't know. Unfortunately, they don't have a lot of political power in Islamabad. Sounds like a...
They're estimating that one-third of the water is going to get diverted.
No, I just can't. I mean, that's a... You know, sounds awful. It just sounds... Talk about a conflict situation. Do that something.
What do we as a country get for the billions of dollars of aid that we give to these countries?
Always a good question. And a question that we ask ourselves every year when we're putting budgets together. So, you're... Foreign assistance budget for years up until 2001 was about $20 to $25 billion a year, as opposed to, now that's civilian aid, food and schools and health care and things like this in about 120 different countries around the world. After 2001, it more or less doubled, with some of that money for the first time going to the Pentagon. Not for weapons, but for humanitarian assistance and for different economic development activities. The Pentagon's budget went from about $400 billion a year, as opposed to $20 billion, to about $700 billion a year after that, part of which was this civilian foreign assistance money. So it comes in a number of different accounts, and in Pakistan's case, I think I had $780 million there for 2015. $785 million, right? This is not military stuff. Put another $800 million on there for military stuff, right? But, so let's say $1.6 billion, right? For 1 year. For Pakistan. Now their budget, their federal budget, was about $24 billion a year. Federal budget for Pakistan. So we were putting in about 5%, right? If my math is okay. Is that right? Okay. And with that, and we don't just give it to them in a suitcase. You know, we just don't, you know, we sit down and we negotiate and we say, we got five things here that we're interested in, we understand you are too. And that's health, that's education, that's infrastructure, that's electricity. We're doing stuff for maintenance on some of their bigger dams. We're doing reconstruction of places that have been bombed by the Taliban up there in the Northwest. More often than not, they would say, okay, yeah, of course, we can use that money. And we would say, all right, but then, in the meantime, you're going to have to promise over the years to do things like fix your tax system, fight corruption, invest more of your own tax money in primary education, not put so much in universities, because your yield at the primary level over the long run, your human capital is much better if you're investing in your primary schools. We said we want you to do that stuff. So we were successful in all those negotiations. Now, whether that stuff sustains itself and continues on and actually makes over the long term a big, you know, sort of a categorical change, if you will, in the direction of where they're going is yet to be seen. But all of the money, at least in Pakistan, all of the money is tightly followed and dispersed. That $785 million goes out over a period of 3 or 4 years in disbursements, in tranches. It isn't, we say, you go up to Congress and say, how much are we giving to country so-and-so? We say, well, $785 million, that's what we have budgeted. We're not giving them $785 million a year. That's what we have budgeted for that fiscal year. So this goes out reflective of different agreements we have with Pakistan or Colombia or Haiti or, well, not Haiti, because we don't deal with them there, Kenya, Egypt. And we give this to them on an agreed upon disbursement basis. Based on what we happen to believe is their decent functioning and proper use of funds. Yes, ma'am.
Why was there such a precipitous drop?
Sorry.
Why was there such a precipitous drop in the aid to both Pakistan and Afghanistan between 2015 and 2016?
Right. Yeah. Usually just before an election. Whoever's, you know, the guys in the Office of Management Budget, the guys on the Hill, guys in the State Department, they're saying, well, we've got, you know, $300 million left. Let's just ask them for about this much. Let's not be overly optimistic, and in any case that's a judicious number. We're still doing stuff. We're losing some personnel this year. People would leave the embassy, all of a sudden, you know, you've got this big portfolio, and you're trying to run it, right? So some of that's reflected there. Pakistanis may have said, we don't need that much now, because you're talking to them, right? And they could have. Yeah. It's happened. Yes, sir.
Well, I guess the question is, do you estimate these millions and millions are worthwhile? What do we get out of this? I mean, it's considering all the troubles that are over there and Taliban insurgents and Afghanistan, especially. What is the alternative?
Yeah, right. I guess the question is, what's the alternative? For me, what you get out of foreign assistance are usually three different things. It's sort of the rubrics under which you try and categorize your planning or your disbursements. One's humanitarian assistance, what we used to call, you know, sort of the old National Geographic projects, right? The do-good stuff. That stuff goes on. Water, education, roads, healthcare, polio program in Pakistan, $400 million over about 4 or 5 years. We had about 23 people killed on that one. You know, women who were going around and getting kids their injections. So there's that. Then you have security issues. Just bald security issues, right, that the U.S. is concerned about. You want to be able to say, and Colombia was famous in this regard, particularly during the drug issues of the 90s and this past decade. You want to make sure that countries are relatively stable. So you do police training, you do judicial reform. The Pentagon comes in, does some military training for a certain sector of your host country security forces. And you maintain a seat at the table. The third thing that you look for that I think is reflected in those portfolios is the fact that you wish to cultivate or maintain or somehow refine market-based economies and trade regimes. And foreign assistance can do a lot in that regard, particularly regarding negotiations, training, subsidies, if you will, through the central bank for a particular product that some country's going to get hit on if they sign a trade agreement. So there's some real politics that goes into those considerations. And then there's, as I say, the old time to sort of, for me, who the U.S. is in many regards with respect to the humanitarian assistance element, a lot of that. is about 0.8% of the federal budget at the moment. Maybe 0.9, 0.9% of the federal budget. Foreign assistance is not military stuff. That's about 1.5% of the federal budget. Do you have a question? Yes, ma'am.
Could you tell me the difference between the Mujahideen and the Taliban?
Sure, I think so. Yeah, now, so the Mujahideen was the term that the Afghan nationalists who were fighting against the Soviets after the Soviets invaded in 1979 took upon themselves or arrogated to themselves, called themselves in warriors, right, Muslim warriors, who were fighting against the Soviet occupation of Afghanistan from 79 to 89, if I'm not mistaken. Taliban were a group of Afghans, and it's from the Arabic word talib, which is student. The Taliban were students who came out of madrasas or schools, a lot of them in Pakistan, actually. These were Afghan refugee kids who spent 10 years in Pakistan studying at usually Saudi-funded madrasas or Quranic schools, and then came back into Afghanistan after the Soviets left, formed their own militia groups, became known as the Taliban, and with the fervor of the newly converted, went around and meted out rough justice to warlords and bad guys throughout Afghanistan, ultimately taking over in 1996. And throwing out a guy named Rabbani and a fellow by the name of Massoud. Rabbani is the Prime Minister, and Massoud is the Defense Minister. Educated, sort of secular Muslim guys who were trying to keep things together after the government, and not only after the Soviets had left, but after then the vestiges of the Afghan government fell apart in 92-93. So the Taliban ruled until 90, until October of 2001, when we essentially went in after 9/11 and attacked them. Now they had assassinated Massoud, who had been fighting against them, who was a Tajik. Most of the Taliban are Pashto from around that line, from around here. Massoud was a Tajik, he was from up here. And about 30% of your current or rather about 70% of your Afghan army officers are Tajiks right now. And he come in with Karzai, who's a Pashto, and who are serving as professional officers in the Afghan army. So the Taliban, so you have the Afghan Taliban. Now you also have the Pakistan Taliban, who have always had connections with the Afghan Taliban, but who are also any number of, there's dozens of these groups in Pakistan, all of whom are proscribed, all of whom are watched over by internal security services, practically all of whom have a fundamentalist Muslim ideology and seek to overthrow the secular government of Islamabad. So when I was there, there were just over 40 of them. I understand there's over 60 of them now. Anywhere, you know, from a dozen guys to maybe a few hundred guys. Now, the most famous is Lakshari Gandhi, Lakshari Taiba, who have gone into New Delhi. You remember the Mumbai 2008 massacre at the hotel there? About 120 people were killed. That was Lakshari Taiba. And then Lakshari Gandhi has blown up any number of places throughout the subcontinent. And I looked and saw in my polls in my papers this past week that, you know, I kept a little bit of a diary. And I'll just, if you'll indulge me for a second, I'm just looking. So February 2013, militants attack an army base in northwest Pakistan on Friday, the 1st of February, in a coordinated assault that left 35 people dead, 13 security personnel, 10 civilians, 12 militants. Same day, about 10 kilometers away, suicide bombers killed some 26 people outside a Shia mosque. This is Muslim on Muslim violence. in a place called Kohut, not far from Waziristan, up there in the northwest. Karachi gets bombed on March 3rd, directed at a Shia neighborhood, kills at least 50 people. Again, back to Muslim on Muslim. Lashkar-e-Jhan comes on, says they're responsible for this. April 4, 2012, blast in the U.S. consulate in Peshawar early last week, kills six people, wounded at least 11 more. Two of our guys were in there, actually, two U.S. citizens, both of them walked away from. And then we closed the consulate, that was the last. Let's see if I can get this. Here's Peshawar. That's where our consulate was. It is no more. It's closed. A couple of brave Pakistani guys are up there running this. So, that's with this grouping, with this large number of discontented Pakistani Taliban, along with their brothers in Afghanistan, you've got this real toxic mix of this, you know, very tense and unstable sort of. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I was wondering about how the villages are set up. Do they have somebody who's sort of like a leader of the Muslim group or the Sunnis and Shiites? Are they separated there? Or how does a village going? I've heard that they do ask for a lot of bribes. If you want to go along a highway, you have to pay a lot of bribes to get anywhere. Is that true?
That's true, I understand, in certain places of Afghanistan. I hadn't heard that in, this is a much more rural area, you know, 80% of your people in Afghanistan have to live outside of cities.
But Pakistan, there are rural areas there, and I just wonder how do they keep going, and do they have anybody that protects them? Do they have somebody who's sort of a leader of a small group? Is it like a tribe?
Yeah, it's like a tribe, yeah. So you, in Pakistan, you basically have
all your relatives will protect
them. This is true. Right.
Okay, so it's based on relatives and who you know, and if you don't know them, then you're in danger.
I think that's not a bad description.
Like that feels good for
it. It can get that way, yeah. And and remember what I said at the beginning of the talk, you know, I was saying institutions are important, right? Institutions. And not to suggest that, you know, there's something unusual about these people, you know, all their fighting and stuff like this. When you get to a situation, you know, where you have 11 kids and you're illiterate and can't get any water, oh, and by the way, you live in a village of 10,000 people and there's a smart guy who knows the Quran and stuff, and he knew your grandfather, and he's relatively articulate, maybe even travels a little bit, he worked in Saudi Arabia during the oil boom or something like this, and he knows somebody in the capital, you're going to adhere to a lot of things and stuff that he said.
Saudi sent a lot of them there.
The Saudis, and so the Saudis in the 80s served us and the CIA in a very helpful way in order to move guns from the Gulf states into Afghanistan through northern Pakistan with the help of what they call the ISI, which is the ISI is basically the Internal Security Services. Again, he's a Charlie Wilson's war. And so the Saudis, we sort of let the Saudis, Reagan administration sort of said to the Saudis, okay, have at it, right? Better you guys than us. And so the Saudis also have always considered themselves sort of the caretakers, not in the music group, of Islam. They wanted to help their Sunni brothers in Afghanistan and Pakistan, even though there are significant Shia minorities in both of those countries. But they also brought in all these fundamentalist imams into Afghanistan and Pakistan, who began to give the dual fundamentalist interpretations of the Quran, establishing, in many ways, of becoming very, you know, allowing this fundamentalist element to coalesce and to be cultivated, that, you know, you're seeing now in your, yeah.
We have a question back here.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Do you see any negotiation being successful between the Taliban and the Afghan government to share power, or is that a high degree? Yeah. And we're going to need to talk more eventually, definitely, or just send it out, or go all off?
Right. Karzai, before he left, and I think Ashraf Ghani has made similar attempts, has gotten the Taliban to sit down and talk and to see if they might be able to get to some type of common ground. None of those talks, either with Karzai or more recently with Ghani, had gotten any place. And I'm not entirely sure why that is. I don't follow that. But again, it's, to me, it's indicative of, you know, their history, their lack of a sense of connection amongst themselves, the fractious tribal and regional considerations. And I'm not real optimistic about that. I'm more optimistic about Pakistan, which I think has better human resources, a better economy, and things like this. These are relative terms, of course, in the long run. And Pakistan getting together with India. Pakistan gets together with India, who they hate, mutual hatred there because of the partition, basically. But the Pakistanis quite reasonably say they were really left out in the cold. They didn't get a lot of things that they asked for, and then the war broke out. But if they got together on a trade basis, I mean, that would just be a powerhouse and an economy and an extremely, regional coalition there if they could come together. And I thought there was a question over. Yes, sir.
Yeah, the more time that these wars in Iraq or Afghanistan are taking, you portray a rosy picture of help and aid, but the more time that these wars are taking, the more the world is keeping a close eye on these wars, and the more the United States is giving the impression that it is failing if it is not going to arrive to a happy conclusion. This situation that the U.S. government goes to a nation and they lead the situation of far wars, say Vietnam, Cambodia, I see, for example, what's happening with ISIS. Is to me very similar to the Khmer Rouge in Cambodia. Uh-huh. That was the direct result, the B-52 bombings, and ISIS is situation of the U.S. military invasion. But do you think the U.S. government is aware of how the world is seeing the U.S. government's credibility, that, go to countries to military or economic resort wrong and they end up in disaster?
Yes, I do think they are. I think they're painfully aware of that in a lot of occasions. It's an interesting thing, you have Woodrow Wilson, Jimmy Carter, Ronald Reagan, George W. Bush, different political parties and different ideological tendencies, all sort of tilting towards this sense that they're able to fix a place, as opposed to your more real politic types, like Roosevelt, like FDR, like Reagan in a sense, Nixon in a sense. He at least wanted to get out of Vietnam, recognizing the mistakes that we made there. And indeed, if you remember, George W. Bush was saying during the campaign, no more nation building. That's a mess. We don't want to get involved in that. That's going to be awful. Of course, in fairness, it was before 9/11. Ultimately, and this is a discussion that goes on in Washington all the time, every year. Should we be there in country X? Should we try and do a certain thing? Do we need to be there? And I think if the consideration is that you want to be able to have some type of influence, you're always going to have some kind of foreign assistance, but it may not be particularly significant. But the big debate for me is, what's your balance? What are your tools going to be? Are you going to have a martial approach? With the Pentagon, I say a kinetic approach. Bomb the daylights out or anything, or are you going to have a more long-term sense of a strategy regarding a particular country or region? And so Yeah, I think that kind of discussion back and forth goes on every single day in Washington amongst the people who are responsible for not only appropriating the money but up on the Hill, but also for those who happen to be responsible for using it.
What's the poppy situation?
Yeah, not good. It's about 200 just was looking at some of these numbers. It's about 224,000 hectares of poppy in Afghanistan at the moment, as opposed to about 30,000. As opposed to about 30,000 towards in 1998, 1999. And that was mainly due to the fact that the Taliban was in there. You know, you get your hands cut off if you were caught producing poppy. It's un-Islamic. Shouldn't be going in, but it's because of places that again is a little bit of a part of foreign assistance too, trying to get rid of that. That started in the late 1970s in Latin America. I think the real Sisyphean sort of job, and just like as if you're not looking at demand issues, you're looking at interdiction issues, you're looking at the source issues, you're looking at the growth issues. And you can't I forget these numbers now, we're working in Colombia a little bit on the cocaine stuff. You know, if a guy makes $400 a month as a peasant farmer just growing his crops, he's making quite a lot of money in certain areas of Colombia. He's making $800 to $1,200 a month processing coca leaf out in the jungle, you know, getting it to a, you know, a guy in a couple of bags and on a mule. You know, there's no way that you're going to wean him off of that unless you can get institutions in your host country government in there to provide the kinds of public services that one would hope for, among other things. Yes, sir.
Yeah. And related to the question back here, so now we're after ISIS. So let's say we defeat ISIS and things are finally over. What should we assume is going to happen with in Afghanistan and Pakistan? Should we just let them shoot each other? They're not going to be terrorists and coming after us, or what? What do you think?
Well, I think that's a Senator Rand Paul sort of solution. Yeah. Where you sort of go and let them shoot at each other. Yeah. And that's not, you know, off the table as far as I know in terms of discussions regarding strategy and what you're going to do. I mean, there is a small element of thought among some of the policy wonks who say, well, not our fight. Let's wait until the dust clears and we'll go in and pick things up. Now, I'm not necessarily partial to that kind of situation. I think it's a little dangerous, but for all kinds of reasons. But I'm not sure. Now, don't forget, I mean, the Afghanis threw the British out three times. And they will tell you that they said Reagan didn't have the Cold War. We did. Because we defeated the Soviets here in Afghanistan. And that led to the fall of the Berlin Wall. Oh, by the way, you guys didn't listen to us after that. Where did you go after that? I'll say to you, right? Why did you not continue to engage with us? Well, the Clinton administration got distracted for a number of reasons. The first Bush administration, and then the Clinton administration. But because of all kinds of things like bureaucratic initiative, inertia, and a little bit of fatigue, as well as the fact that Congress just didn't want to appropriate money for that particular part of the world anymore, you sort of left them to their own devices, allowing the warlords to fight to the death until the Taliban come in 1996. Pakistanis recognized them along with the United Arab Emirates, so they're the only two countries in the world who recognize the Taliban government at that time. And then you get this vacuum into which guys like Osama bin Laden, the Saudi, right, who fought against the Russians, comes in. He gets kicked out of Saudi Arabia because he's criticizing the king. He gets tossed out of the Sudan. Well, that's something. And he winds up in Afghanistan, where he continues, where he starts his conspiracy stuff. So my point, the Afghans are not to be underestimated. And I think ultimately, like most of us, you know, it's kind of want to be left alone
to do their own thing, right?
The big issue there is how they're going to function, what they're going to do. They got tremendous mineral resources, but a $20 billion a year GNP. I mean, I think California's is $1.2 trillion. You know, it's just like they're in a different, whole different universe. And this one, a good book, The Places in Between, by a guy named Rory Stewart, who used to be head of the Brit, he walked from Herat to Kabul in 2002 and survived. But he talks about that Afghan character. Maybe, yes, sir. Yeah.
In the areas of Taliban control, is that control largely a result of imposition of military power, or is there significant popular support?
Yeah, I hear that there's significant popular support. There is quite a large element that is perfectly fine with the Taliban running things. Again, lack of public institutions, lack of governance, lack of a predictable sort of market economy and functioning regulation, and other than familial tribal sort of connections. And the Taliban put some order on that. And guys who have served, who I've worked with, who have served in Afghanistan, oftentimes said to me, you know, that if you talk to people, particularly in the south, in Afghanistan, on Kandahar, which is where the top of the Al-Qaeda actually set up first, and the Taliban came to power. They're perfectly happy, as long as there's some type of structure. Some colleagues of mine did a survey up around here with respect to the Pakistani tribal groups up there. And said to the women, what do you think of Sharia law? They said, it would be great if you put Sharia law on. Well, why is that? Well, the Quran allows women to inherit wealth. If our husbands beat us, they're going to be thrown in jail. Our kids can get educated. And there's going to be some type of transparent legal structure here that we can rely on. It's going to be written down. So, sure, put something in place in order to protect us and allow us to function decently. They're not thinking of being constrained in their movements and social abilities and stuff like this. They're just basically saying, give us some type of framework through which we can function as a society. We thought that was an interesting sort of reaction. Indicating, again, you know, just no sense or presence, if you will, with public and private institutions.
With the proposed reductions in the budget for the Department of State, how do you see that affecting this area of the world in the future, or any area of the world?
Yeah. It's just, if it's cut this year, the effects will be felt, even if it's put in again or jacked up, increased next year. Those cuts will be felt in over a couple of years. So what'll happen is that at the State Department and in the Pentagon and places like this where people talk about this stuff, there'll be some horse trading and with Congress, and you'll say, well, you know, just to throw out them. So we had $40 billion last year worldwide, Congress has given us $28 billion. I guess we're not going, what countries are you interested in? Well, which ones are really strategic to us? Well, Afghanistan and Pakistan, Israel, Kenya, Colombia, Haiti, the Northern Triangle, you've got Honduras, El Salvador, and Guatemala, South Sudan, which is a mess, and has lots of oil. Yemen, which gets a lot of humanitarian assistance, those places will probably come to the fore a little bit. and then your other places which could use it, certainly from a developmental aspect, you know, certainly for sustainability over the long run, those will be the ones that will suffer. So some pretty rough, you know, difficult decisions will be made. Couple more, yes, sir.
You mentioned that the hectares of poppy are just
right.
More than ever.
Right.
Isn't that one of the stipulations of foreign aid? When a country gives foreign aid, that one of the stipulations to curb
it
down.
It is, yeah.
But it hasn't happened.
On that, yes,
so
yeah,
still poppy fields for
numbers that I saw. Yeah, so 224 or 225,000 hectares. That was a hectare, like 2.6 acres, if I'm not mistaken. That's a lot.
Yeah.
And yes, it is. My understanding of that program is that, like in Colombia, where you've got your coca leaves and stuff like this, you have an extremely isolated cultivation area. You also have really nasty armed bad guys around these places. Number two. Number three, you probably have some kind of connections amongst government officials in the either, you know, at the local, provincial, national level. Most of it goes out of two places, I understand. Most of it, you get a lot of it through here, and most of it goes this way, through Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, into Moscow, and ultimately into Europe. And it goes out of Karachi, and then down here into East Africa, and through some relatively well-established smuggling efforts. But indeed, yeah, it is. And frankly, the World Bank or the IMF will step in every once in a while and say, we're not going to give you that loan until you cut down on opium cultivation. We'll give you 2 years.
Right. They're probably using a lot more of their cells. Just
for lack
of it is there.
Yeah, the war on drugs has always been a little bit of a misnomer, maybe because it's always been heavy on the enforcement and interdiction side, as opposed to the education and the demand side, particularly here in the States. You just can't, you know, as long as that demand is there, as long as you got people putting that stuff up their noses, you know, you're going to create that kind of market. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Going back a bit to whether it's worthwhile to supply all billions of dollars in aid.
Right.
And you may have answered part of this with your statement of there is local support for the Taliban, but if we supply humanitarian assistance and a sense of security or stability through our aid, why, if we're, I would think we would be the good guys, so why do these people hate us and burn our flags? And also, talking about trade, maintain a trade presence with these countries. What do we trade? I mean, we get cheap labor goods, you know, clothing, things like that. What do we get out of it? If we want to get those cheap clothes, we probably have to make them here at a higher price, but at least we have a larger economy here.
Maybe, yeah. But back to your first thing about, so I'm not sure why they hate us, other than, you know, and I don't know why, you know, in a lot of instances they happen to react like that. I would say that I think that the amount of money that we put into those places in relative terms probably isn't enough to really sort of turn the tide and influence people, you know, to, if you will, to be on our side or to like us. I don't know that we're ever going to be able to do that. But what I do think we're able to do is to maintain some type of connection with these places, which is important for me, because of the fact that we're all connected and integrated now. And the fact that there's a conflict on the other side of the world, for one thing, fortunately, it's on the other side of the world. Secondly, but just as importantly, it connects with us in any case, because of our interconnection regarding everything from communication to security issues to travel to migration to refugees and everything like this. And that's all a part of the cachet or the ante, if you will, that we've got in terms of foreign assistance. We can be there at the table. We can be there when these things break out. We can be there in order to talk about these issues and discussions and negotiate with all of these countries around the world and tell them in sometimes rather friendly ways and sometimes rather somewhat threatening ways. If this doesn't get fixed, then the following is going to happen. And so it's tough to measure, particularly on a yearly basis. Congress always asks us for that, right? What did you lay? How many babies did you save, right? How many kids did you get? How many kilometers of roads did you build? Why not? How many hectares of coca or poppy did you get rid of? Why not? Right? You're always answering those questions. And sometimes you have some good answers, sometimes you say, oh geez, yeah, we really messed up. We messed up because of these things. But it's a relatively small amount of money, I would argue, as well as some of my colleagues, that keeps us at the fore. And they don't have to like us, I always would say about some of my friends, you know, because they don't know a lot about our country, except what they see, God help us, you know, in some of the TV programs and stuff like that. So we ask for our country. But we do have to, ideally, and I think this is true of most people around the world. You know, there are some fundamentally normative and common issues amongst us that we all happen to adhere to and share. And those need to be cultivated and not forgotten. And I think that's what a lot of our diplomats and our foreign aid does overseas.
And the trade issue?
The trade issue, I think, yeah. So Pakistan's our biggest trading partner, or rather, we are their biggest market. Garments, some machinery, chemicals, some Bangladesh is another one. Clothing, right? $40 a month for a worker in a Bangladeshi clothing factory. Now, it provides jobs for all of those. There's 165 million people in Bangladesh. It's the size of Wisconsin. Wisconsin's got 6.5 million people. Bangladesh has 165 million people. Geographically, physically, they're the same size. So if you've got, and I'm making this number up now, I don't know, if you've got 20 million working in your garment industry in Bangladesh, and that means that they're not becoming fundamentalist jihadis, and there is an element there in Bangladesh, in that Muslim country. That may not be a bad yield. Right? Yeah. Those are the kinds of decisions you get involved with. I appreciate that question. I think, yes, ma'am.
Here you've had assignments all over the world. If Rex Tillerson asked you, brought you into his office and asked you, said you could go wherever you wanted, where would you go back? Where would you go?
Yeah. That's
good.
Well, there's some places that I haven't seen, so I might like Buenos Aires, you know, which I've never been to. Or South Africa. Australia, where my father served in World War II with the Australians against the Japanese, would be interesting. So, just off the top of my head, at the moment, I'm more than content to sit around and see your birds.
And we have one final question this evening.
At your last tour of duty, were you able to move around safely without security?
No. So, just quickly, because so I lived in a residential area, an Islamabad, Pakistani residential area, in an old house that the embassy rented from a Pakistani guy. And there were two or three other officers on my street. And I would get picked up in the morning and then taken home at night in an embassy car. And at a different time, within about a 2.5 to 3 hour window in the morning, 2.5 to 3 hour window in the evening. And you're always, it's always different. And you get a printout of your schedule usually in the evening for the security guys when you get picked always want is just security 101, right? You don't want to establish a pattern. I didn't have a car, so I would, and then I'd get to the office, and the office in Islamabad is about a 10 square mile area, actually, where all the embassies are. The Saudis, the Jordanians, the French, and the Brits, and everybody's in there, the UN, Chinese, and Russians, and so. But I couldn't, I would slip out sometimes, oh, and you have two guards, usually I have four guys at the house all the time. The two guys at the house all the time, in the morning, two guys in the house, and the evening. Everybody, yeah. You can imagine walking around like this in Islamabad by yourself. You know? You're not from here. So you're. And it was just, it was always a little. People ask me what it was like, and I used to start to bloviate a little bit, you know, about Pakistan and this and that, and until their eyes glazed over after about 20 seconds. Now when people ask me, I just say, in response to how other, I say, really tense. It was probably the tensest place I think I've ever lived.
Were you there continually for 3 years?
No, I was just there for 15 months.
And you didn't leave for 15 months?
I did, actually. Yeah, I left about 4 or 5 times. Yeah, okay. Right, to come back for 2-3 weeks and then go to Washington. Right. Yeah, they get you out.
Was your wife there too?
No, Annie had, no, it was what they call a Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iraq, Somalia, Yemen, places like this are what they call non-accompanied or unaccompanied posts. So just the office rules. Now there's some, now in this day and age, there are tandem officers, husband and wife, no kids, right? And a real pleasure. Thank you so much.
It's coming around on the 10th anniversary. Remember, if you're so inclined to fill out those surveys, leave them over on the table over there. One final reminder, remember to vote a week from tomorrow, April 4th. Thank you very much for coming, everyone.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah. 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 Yeah.